hearing me? This is loud. All right. Welcome to my TED Talk. Just kidding. I'm really, really grateful for all of you being here, taking time out of this beautiful day to be with me. This lecture recital is themed on the piano music of John Sibelius. And the reason I chose this topic is because I came across some of his piano pieces and they really, really moved me. And I thought, you know, his piano works are often overlooked a lot, so I'm hoping to shed a little bit of light on them today for you. If I go into stuff that's like too musicological or too theory-based, like, don't worry about it. Just thank you for being here. So a little bit about Sibelius as a person. He lived from 1865 to 1957, one of those longer-lived composers. He was actually born into a Swedish-speaking Finnish family. And he married in 1892 into a highly influential nationalist liberal family in Finland. He was largely self-taught in music until about the age of 20, which is when he studied a little bit more in an official capacity in Berlin and Vienna, primarily a violinist. Today there is a certain continuing legend about Sibelius. He's kind of seen as this late romantic, nature-loving man of the North. Here are some typical quotes describing his music. Quote, "Delicate idylls, virtuosic dramas, humorous pastiches, and nature scenes steeped in Finnish mystery." Another one, his works are, quote, "sprinkled with the Sibelian gold dust of a great symphonist working at the keyboard, a master of invention, a nature mystic, and a stylistic genius." Almost by default, Sibelius and his works his style really has become a symbol of Finnish nationalism. However, that's not necessarily what he initially set out to do. So what kind of a composer was he really? Well, more than anything, he was one who was seeking after a unique compositional style, and he appears to have soaked in influence from all over the place. So my first question is, was he really Finnish? I already mentioned already that his relationship with the Finnish language was a little bit difficult. He was a native Swedish speaker. So he worked to learn the language, but it never came that easily to him, much to the chagrin of his wife and his father-in-law especially. To quote one analysis, his becoming a symbol of Finnish nationalism, quote, was an ironic achievement, accomplished in part because he never lost the outsider's perspective. That perspective made his self-fashioning into a Finnish patriot a clearly conscious task. As he acquired this new sensibility, he rebelled against classicist and romantic conventions in music and embraced his own extrapolations of what he regarded to be authentic folk traditions and the musical implications of the ancient Finnish epic. In 1891, Sibelius had a turning point experience. He heard some runic dirges sung by Lorin Peraski. These were basically folk music of ancient Finnish people. He was hooked. He started collecting runic songs, especially from the Russian-controlled region of eastern Karelia, which is now part of Finland. He published a bunch of these in 1895. This experience of being exposed to Finnish runic songs informed many of his stylistic choices in his compositions. Sibelius said, "It is clearly to be seen that our modern tonal system is swaying." Now, this is around the end of the 19th century, so he was right. "But the old should not be torn down without there being something new to replace it." To quote one scholar, through his interest in runic songs, Sibelius did not react against the tonal system, but on its behalf. He was essentially critical of modernism then, but he was also critical of anything he saw as bloated romanticism. So he turned to these folk songs, or these runic songs, in order to find something in a sort of middle ground, a new direction. Keep in mind that Sibelius never went straight to an ethnomusicological process like Bartok or Kodály. If anything, his process parallels Janáček's derivation of a musical idiom from the Czech language. But he never quoted folk songs directly, as far as we know. In fact, he said himself, "So far, I have never made use of any themes but those which are absolutely my own." So going beyond a purely traditional tonal language, Sibelius' works have been noted for his use of modality, modal borrowing, and scalar melodies. This was directly influenced by his observations from runic songs. There it is. So here's an example of one of those songs, and you can see that it's pretty limited in melodic scope, right? It's basically just five notes. And that's something that he noted a lot about these songs, is that generally they would stay within five notes, often in a modal scale. And going maybe to the sixth or seventh scale degree just for expressive moments where the words were is particularly meaningful. His modal music treats the tones of the scale as equal in weight and importance. So perhaps with a stronger final tone, but with less need for leading tones and resolution of dissonance. So you can see this song goes straight back to D all the time, but it doesn't necessarily have tonic and dominant as we would traditionally see in Western canonical music. This kind of music, moving around the diatonic scale between scalarly associated pitches, helps there to be modulation without the need for extra accidentals or too much lush chromaticism. A weakening of the traditional tonic and dominant conception really helps it to find a different sound. Sibelius also often uses polymodality, which may lead to what could be seen as extended triads, but which is actually functioning as two different modes, leading into, say, a ninth chord, but moreover just extending harmonic ambiguity. So here's another example of someone's analysis of one runic song that they thought might have influenced this second impromptu from his Opus 5. You can notice that Sibelius did throw in some F sharps in there to act as a little bit of a leading tone, but the general conception of the limited scope of the melody is still there, and especially in terms of rhythmic and cyclical quality of the melody. So let's talk just a little bit about how this fits into the greater picture of European musical influences. This is a map from around the 1890s of European borders. So Sibelius is often thought of as kind of a late romantic German-influenced composer, but he himself said that his methods were, quote, far removed from the kind of thinking of the German school. And I'll add, it was especially far removed from later modernists like Schoenberg. One funny quote I found is that he thought that Schoenberg's greatest achievement was Avant Barre. So his modal approach, along with non-traditional dissonance treatment and compound chords, makes Sibelius stand out from the late romantic composers who are more tied to Germanic thinking. And then while playing through dozens of his pieces, I couldn't help but notice that beyond some clear modal writing, there tended to be a sort of rhapsodically cyclical character through the repeated use of return harmonies and repeating phrases that carried only slight alterations without truly developing out of the primary mood. To me, this free-floating and harmonic treatment seemed to echo more impressionism than romanticism. This was confirmed a little bit readings. A recent dissertation by Maxwell Gromage describes the phenomenon of alternating chord progressions as transcendental oscillation. And I love that term. He went on to compare the musical treatment between Debussy and Sibelius. Of Sibelius's transcendental oscillations, he said that it's generally more contrapuntal and stratified, longer on average, with long passages of music that seem to go nowhere. Further, Debussy's inspiration perhaps drew more from Greek paganism and many other exotic traditions, whereas Sibelius's single uniform style was grounded in the folk music of Finland and evokes a mythology more Nordic than Hellenic. Sibelius also said that Debussy was, quote, neither grand nor profound, refined, but in my view, small scale. Harsh words. it's also been described that much French music around the turn of the century featured a certain technique of juxtaposition between musical cells. This repetition aided form to move along without reverting to Germanic styles of development. So repetition, planing, a certain emancipation of the need for resolution due to modal treatment, creates an entirely different sound world from the harmonic development of German music. What about the Russian? As you can see in this map here, there's a border going up with a red dash. Hopefully you can see it. It's kind of far away. Some of that is the Karelia region from where Sibelius drew so much inspiration, and it belonged to Russia at the time. A lot Lado Savaisa's 1890s music was relatively patriotic. Finland was hoping to become more independent from Russia, but Russia was still exercising great authority. One of my own observations is that Savaisa's cyclical treatment of melody is perhaps not unlike much Russian music or other folk music for that matter, which cycles through recastings and reframings of the original melody instead of developing it in a dramatic way. So here's the big question then from all of this. What is Sibelius' legacy in terms of nationalism? Like, what does it really mean? Because of unique approaches to composition, he was perhaps more a visionary than a reactionary. Over time, he created branching away further and further from the European mainland mainstream. He advocated much for the tonality and modality of Finnish folk music, the rhythm of the Finnish language, and the evocative power of Finnish mythology. This nationalist interest is not too far removed from many other similar movements for nationalism inspired in one way or another by the linguistic nationalism of the German philosopher Johann Gottfried von Herder. There have been comparisons made between Sibelius' music and that of Arnold Bax and Ray Vaughan Williams, and even Anton Bruckner, who wrote much music that exhibits a similar kind of harmonic stasis as Sibelius. So perhaps the real goal was to find new modes of expression without wholly breaking ties with coherence and accessibility. To quote from an interview with Sibelius, taking place later in his life, quote, "A section of Sibelius' own countrymen regard him as the symbol of Finnish nationalism, for there are many Finns who visualize a Finland purged of Swedish intruders." Ironic, since he was a Swedish-speaking person. To this party, it is of the greatest significance that Sibelius' daughters were educated at a Finnish, not a Swedish school. But Sibelius himself is remote from party politics and movements of that sort. In his comfortable, simple house at Järvenpää, he lives well, reads and entertains occasional visitors with lavish hospitality, and declines to say a word about the Eighth Symphony for which all the world is waiting. Okay, so let's talk about the piano music. There he is at the piano, holding a violin bow. there, it's a little bit problematic. He's often been accused of disliking the piano, and his music has been accused of being non-pianistic because of some of the things he said. Here we go. Talking to his student composer Bengt von Terna, he said, "I am an orchestral man. You must judge me on the basis of my orchestral works. I write piano pieces in my leisure time. Actually, the piano does not interest me since it can't sing. And I never go to piano concerts unless they're given by a true genius like my friend Busoni." He said in an interview that he doesn't actually use the piano when he composes symphonic works. He said, "I dislike the piano. It is an unsatisfactory, ungrateful instrument, an instrument for which only one composer, Chopin, has succeeded in writing perfectly, and of which only two others, Debussy and Schumann, have had an intimate understanding." Okay, so he didn't hate on Debussy that much. He was also apparently quoted as telling his six daughters that he wrote piano music so that they could have bread and butter on the table. I don't think that means that they were of lesser quality, necessarily. If anything, I would think that as a father, he'd put a lot of effort into making sure his piano works were worthwhile of being published to earn that money that he needed. And to be frank, I'm sure he needed some extra funding to be able to continue composing his symphonies. However, on the other side of the table, according to his secretary, Santeri Levas, Sibelius himself had a completely different view of his piano pieces. He appreciated them to the full and considered the opinion of the musical world unfair. He said, "I know that they have a secure future. I know it despite the fact that they have completely fallen into oblivion." Sibelius added that one day his piano pieces might become as popular as those of Schumann. It hasn't quite happened, but what confidence, right? If he was just writing throwaway pieces, it would be difficult to say something like that. Interestingly, his piano works are actually more numerous than his works for violin, which was his main instrument. Here are some pictures of him at the piano. All of him in his old age. I couldn't find any younger ones. But according to contemporaries, Sibelius actually had considerable pianistic skills. He would charm his audiences with improvised fantasies, even though instrument, and he wasn't necessarily a professional pianist. He was no slouch either. All told, he wrote over 150 works for the piano solo. 115 of these were published with opus number in his life, many without opus number. There are also many transcriptions of his orchestral works, and perhaps Busoni played many of them. Beyond that, he wrote 100 songs with piano accompaniment, more than 50 chamber works with piano, and in fact, the piano is included in more than half of Sibelius's roughly 700 compositions. For someone who supposedly hates the piano, that's a lot of self-inflicted torture. Generally, Sibelius's piano works are relatively short, and they're often grouped together in collections. As you can see from the list here, a lot of them are 10 pieces, 4 pieces, 5 pieces, 13. I don't think we need to discredit his piano writing simply for focusing on smaller works. Sibelius said, one has to combine things, great and small, symphonies and songs. He had bitter opinions about the difficulties of working with publishers to make small and accessible scores of his larger works, especially making them accessible to amateurs who are not likely to afford a conductor's score. I think that perhaps this was another motivation to publish more works that would be immediately accessible via the piano. One example of a successful large form piano work is the Kaliki, Opus 41, which is three lyric pieces based on subjects from the Kalevala. That's a 19th century work of epic Finnish poetry and old folklore mythology. It's really an interesting thing. It follows a bit of a story. That Kaliki is the primary example of a successful large form, but generally, I don't think large form was the goal of these piano works. It was the musical ideas encapsulated in them. My own discovery of this piano work has been quite enjoyable, hence this recital today. I played through dozens and dozens of these things trying to find ones that I can pick out, because so much of it was so good, and it was hard to choose. Some of the pieces are quite virtuosic. For example, from the Opus 58, there's a piece called In the Evening that was really a struggle for me. As you play through it, it's tempting to call much of it non-pianistic. It doesn't always fit into the hand in the same way as maybe Chopin would, but really it just requires some different listening and some different approaches, I think. More than technical fireworks, they require an attention to shape, to voicing, and to touch. Not surprising coming from someone who is so ingrained in writing symphonic works, you know, it's all about the symphonic coloring. So it's not really useful to underestimate Sibelius' pianistic talent. Each piece makes a very clear musical statement with limited means. In effect, they're not just trashy salon pieces for easy accessibility to the amateur. Maybe some of them are, sure. But there's merit to them as a miniature glimpse into his larger sound world, bringing nature or the symphony into the home and into the heart with clarity and concision. They've also been loved enough to merit, to my count, almost a dozen recordings of the complete piano works, which is a big undertaking. Some of the albums of complete works are up here. There are more. The reception of his piano works by other pianists has been also largely very favorable. Glenn Gould, who recorded a lot of Grieg and Sibelius, said, quote, "Sibelius never wrote against the grain of the keyboard. Everything works. Everything sings, but on its own terms." Sibelius was able to make a significant addition to the far too limited piano repertoire of late Romanticism. Eero Heimonen said that Sibelius' piano works have technical difficulties, to be sure, but generally the piano texture is melodious and colorful, but unlike any other piano style. Okay, so let's get into some of the works I'll actually be playing for you today. One of them is his only piano sonata, and I think that this work, which was composed just barely after his first experiences with these runic songs that I mentioned earlier, this is a really big example of modality being used in combination with traditional tonality. The second movement in particular was very interesting to me. First of all, it begins in F minor, and then it ends in B flat minor. So already there's, just from the large scale form, This second movement features a slow modal chorale with an almost Slavic quality to the melody. There's an example up here. And you can see that all of these shifting chords, they remain diatonic. And there's not really a push or pull either way for there to be resolution of dissonance. This modal shifting of related harmonies prolongs the melody and resists resolution. It's contrasted with a two-voice Phrygian dance that appears twice. There's an example up on the screen. The form of this sonata's second movement, I think, where it shifts between slow chorale and scherzo, mirrors to me the second movement of Grieg's piano sonata, which was written in 1865, same year of Sibelius the Firth. Sibelius continues to use this kind of form in future works, most notably to create the form of the single movement Seventh Symphony. An example of some oscillatory or cyclical writing is from The Birch. This is from a set of pieces called The Trees. I'll be playing two of them today. You can see that the left hand features these rotating harmonies, and then it eventually just settles, alternating between two. This repetitive left-hand oscillation of harmony, while a melody is placed on top, has almost a mythological connection, I think, with nature. This is frequently discussed in connection with Sibelius' music, but it's important to note that as a romantic symbol for Sibelius, the wilderness of nature evokes a world apart from human life, something different. The oscillatory cyclical nature of his music invites a sort of meditation or a glance into an eternal natural stasis. He also uses similar textures and repetitive devices in his tone poems and symphonies. As an example of static textural writing, the opening of the first movement of the piano sonata features this almost tremolo-type thing in the left hand. Il Mare, forgive my pronunciation here, Hanekainen, a prominent Finnish composer, said, quote, "The F major piano sonata is a splendid work. It's fresh, refreshing, and full of life. I've sometimes heard people mention the orchestral tone of the sonata, meaning the left-hand tremolos. In my opinion, the sonata shows Sibelian piano style at its most genuine. There's no question of there being many tremolos in it. Everything that looks like that is really to be played in quavers or semi-quavers in the manner of, say, Beethoven piano sonatas. When it is well and carefully rehearsed and performed, the F major sonata is truly a virtuosic piece." And I agree, I mean, it can seem a little bit dull to have such a long prolongation of just da-da-da-da-da-da-da, but it really works as a rhythmic device and setting up a sort of atmosphere. As an example of a lot of the lightness and texture and articulative sprightliness in his piano writing, I really enjoy The Spruce, which is the other piano piece from The Trees that I'll be playing today. It features these two-part textures. Very transparent, simple, and direct. To quote from the critic K.F. Vassanius, of a different set of pieces, the Opus 34 Bagatelles and the Opus 40 Ten Lyrical Thoughts, which are similar in texture. He says, "There's no heaviness, no great chords, and yet such a rich play of colors. Indeed, this is precisely why there is so much grace in the music created by Sibelius' master hand. The more one hears it, the more one is beguiled by it." Sibelius himself wrote after finishing this work that it belonged to his light style and that the pieces are fresh. So the big question of all of this is, are these pieces of any worth? Are they worth our time? What's their approachableness? Are they useful pedagogically? Are they enjoyable musically? And are they programmable? I think that the clarity and economy of expression in them is laudable. They express much without the need for the prolixity of some other late Romantic composers. For Sibelius, to quote one critic, "The musical idea is the point, not the pianistic fireworks." They're often pianistically interesting, however. Even that static left-hand texture that I mentioned presents opportunities for a different approach. Granted, not every work that he wrote for the piano is gold, but very few composers have earned that rank. My opinion is that they deserve to be played, taught, and recognized as music that can communicate both to lay audiences and musicians. assembled some of the stock photos to help communicate a little bit of the feeling I hope to evoke with each piece. And I really, really hope that you